These are in listen-only mode.
Greetings and welcome to this joint DCMI ACIST webinar. I'm Tom Baker, a member of the DCMI Directorate. This webinar is one of a series of joint DCMI ACIST webinars, which are presented as a service to members of DCMI and ACIST and to other interested members of the public. The purpose of the joint series is to advance the discourse and practices of innovative metadata. You will have an opportunity to ask the presenters questions near the close of the webinar. There's a panel on the right of your screen where you can enter the text for your questions. We ask that you wait to enter your text until near the end of the webinar. I will moderate the questions and answers and will address as many questions as our time allows. We have two presenters today, both of whom were editors of the recent document Data on the Web Best Practices, which was published as a W3C recommendation in January. They are Caroline Bourle and Newton Calegari, and I believe they're calling in from the Web Technology Study Center, which is also the W3C office in Brazil. And so without further ado, I'll hand over to Caroline.
Thank you, Tom. Hello, everyone. Thank you for the invitation. We are really happy to be here. So as Tom explained, I'm Caroline, and I work here with Newton in the Web Technology Study Center, which is a department of the NICBR. NICBR, NIC.BR, is the domain name is names and domain organization in Brazil. And it also hosts the W3C Brazil office. So we have these two hats here. And we had the pleasure to be two of the three editors of the Data on the Web Best Practice recommendation. It's a W3C recommendation standard. And Bernadette Loscio, unfortunately, she couldn't be here with us today, but she's also a Brazilian. And she works at the University of Pernambuco. She's a teacher there. So just to give you some context for people who actually don't know or never heard about W3C, I'm so sorry for people who already know about it, but I'll explain very briefly that the World Wide Web Consortium is the organization responsible for developing the web standards. So this document and this recommendation that we will talk about today and all the challenges and benefits to publish data on the web, and this is inside the data activity of the W3C, so it belongs to this area that developed the data standards. So I think it's important to mention for people who don't know the W3C, for instance, you might have heard about the HTML. So the HTML5 is the new standard regarding that. Also the CSS is another standard. There are many standards about web accessibility. Nowadays, the W3C is starting standards on Internet of Things on the web, also virtual reality and on. So there are many standards produced by this organization. And I think it's also important to mention to you that W3C is a consortium. So many organizations are affiliated to it. And there is a worldwide working on that. So for instance, this work that we'll talk about today was actually built for many, many hands. So people from all over the world could join and participate on this development. So if your organization is a member of W3C, you might already know what I'm talking about. And if not, you may become a member to actually be more active in the development of web standards. So, for instance, everyone can actually help developing the web standards because it's all documented on the web, it's all open. So if you're not affiliated, you can interact by mail, for example. But if you are a member, then you have the opportunity to be more active, and also you have obligations like participating in the meetings. So the document that we'll show you and all the best practices we've developed, they had the contribution from many people, were more than 20 people in the working group, there were. And also we added the document, but that doesn't mean that we wrote it all. So I think it's very important to mention that. So the idea now is to give you some context of what we are going to discuss today. So the idea is, first of all, to explain what is the data on the web context, what does it mean? Also, talking about the use cases we collected. So we collected a lot of data on the web use cases, and from that was the use cases were the basis of the very beginning of our work. We started this work more than 2 years, almost 3 years ago, actually. And the recommendation is very, very new. So we published in last January 2017. So you see how we got there. Then how did we get there? We actually understood what were the challenges and the requirements from these use cases. So the data on the web challenge and requirements we got from the use cases that we studied and we collected. And then from that requirements, we developed the best practice. So we had a long way to go until getting the data on the web best practice. And then finally, we will explain to you what are the benefits to when you apply the data on the web best practice. So that's what we're going to discuss today. And first of all, we think it's very important to explain this difference between data on the web, open data, and linked data. Because since the data on the web best practice working group and the document, of course, is in the data activity area of W3C, and it's important to mention that it's not linked data or only linked open data. Of course, this could be, we could be talking about that as well. The best practice apply for linked open data or open data itself or only linked data. But in the end, we are talking about data on the web in general. So there is this very important difference between all of these subjects that we should mention. So if you are talking about open data, of course, we should follow the open data principles. If you are talking about linked open data, then we must follow the linked open data principles. And for people who don't know anything about it, about these topics, we of course can send you links afterwards, and there are also other W3C recommendations about linked open data and also about open data. And finally, we can also be talking about linked data that's not actually open. So for instance, it's very, very important that we know we are talking about data on the web in general. It can gather all this kind of data, but doesn't mean it's only open data or only linked open data or only linked data. All right? So this is the first figure you'll see on the document, data on the web best practice, because it gives us the context on data on the web, about data on the web. So if we think about data on the web, we have first to think about a data set and metadata. So it's very important that we think about the web architecture principles. So it must follow these principles, and also it must use vocabularies and standards. So this is the basis of our work after We've done all the research on the use cases and got the requirements. We understood that this is the basis that we get from to develop all the best practice. So this context is very, very important for us. And please keep in mind this figure. So we also can think about the players of the data on the web ecosystem. And that's also important for the data on the web best practice, because if you think about it, we have several types of data sources. We might have transactional systems, sensors, mobile devices, documents, etc., so on and so on. So how do we actually enable the data reuse? It's very important to keep in mind that the data publisher, that person wants to publish and share the data, right? And the data consumer wants to use or reuse the data, and that person might generate new data. So these are, we can say these are the main actors or the main players in this ecosystem that we are dealing here. So regarding that, we have to think how to enable the data reuse. That is our main question. So how these two cute little kids, they can talk with each other? If we think that someone wants to publish the data and someone wants to consume the data, we need to have a common understanding between the data publishers and the data consumers. So this is very, very important. This is fundamental, actually. So without this agreement, the data publishers' efforts may be incompatible with the data consumers' desires. And that's why we created the set of best practices. It's a set of 35 best practices that Newton will explain for you in a little bit. And this would be like a kind of a bridge, you know, you can think of a bridge connecting two worlds. So this will serve, first of all, of course, for publishers, everyone who publishes data, but also for consumers, because that's the way they can actually understand each other. And even though most of the best practices are focused on the publishers and how to publish a best practice, starting with metadata, that's very, very important, but also talks about giving feedback, so the point of view of the consumer as well. So that's the basis, actually. So how to enable the data reuse is using best practice that we can put them together to actually talk to each other. So getting to the document I've mentioned so many times, the data on the web best practice, it was a very hard work from this working group. Here you can see a photo, a picture of some of a very small part of the group. It was a meeting we had to the pleasure to host here at NICPR in São Paulo. And maybe now I could also mention that this was the first W3C working group that had very high participation of Brazilians, and was the first time there were three Brazilians as editors, and this Brazilian community participated so well. So actually not, of course, well, but with so many people in it. So the idea was, first of all, when you start a working group in W3C, I'm sorry again for people that already know that, but for people who don't know it, it starts with a charter. So a charter is like a public letter that you publish after you have the members' approval, saying what are the goals you must achieve, and what is the mission of that working group. So the mission of the Data on the Web Best Practice Working Group, which is, as I said, part of the data activity in W3C, first of all, was to develop the open data ecosystem, facilitating a better communication between developers and publishers. So, if you remember the figure we just showed you before with the little kids, is exactly like that. The best practice serve like this bridge between both of them. Also, another very important thing to do in this working group as a mission was to provide guidance to publishers so that could improve consistency in the way data is managed and also promote the reuse of data. And finally, to foster trust in the data among developers. So whatever technology they use, they choose to use, they could increase the potential for genuine innovation. I think it's very important to mention here two things. One of them is that this publication and all of the W3C publications are technology agnostic, meaning that we, as W3C doesn't say, oh, use this or that technology, but you can use whatever technology. The important thing is to use the web standards that will provide, will make easier to the technology you will choose to use. And another thing is that the trust in the data, right? We are in the center of the data. People say data is the new oil right now. So we must trust the data we are using. So that's very, very important. And that's one of the principles we had during all this, the development of this work. Because if you don't trust the data you are going to use, how can you actually use it and provide innovation and make new business? So that's very important. Then we get to the use case I mentioned. So right in the beginning of the working group, back then in 2014, we started developing this data on the web use cases. So this was the first document we published. Everything we are going to show here is online, is very well documented, and you can access very easily. This is the URL for accessing this document, and was published as a note in 2015, and was very important because from that use cases, you can see the summary there, the table of contents, we got many, many challenges. So, for instance, data.gov.br, which is or data.gov.us. We have the data.gov.br here as an example that we actually use it. So we had many challenges that they faced when publishing data on the web. And from many different challenges all over the world, we got some challenges, some examples. So from these use cases, after getting this challenge, we understood what were the requirements we had to actually achieve the development of the best practice. So it was very important to get these use cases from the beginning to follow up with the best practice. So now I will kindly ask Newton to explain to you about these requirements and about the best practice, and afterwards we'll be here to discuss with you. Okay, thank you very much.
Thanks, Carol. Hello. Here. From now on, I will explain the challenges and the kind of questions we figure out when we are working on this data on the web best practice document. As Carol just said, we started collecting some use case and evidence, analyzing them, and when analyzing them, we found some requirements specific for each case. Like in US, it's a way they publish, in Brazil, it's this way, in Europe, in different way. So from those use case, we collect some challenges, and with those challenges, we realized that publishing data on the web is more than just publishing the data itself. We have to have in mind some questions and some considerations, like how to make data available, what's the best way to make this data available, how to make the data interoperable. So are we going to use vocabularies to do that? Are we going to use another approach? And how to identify data resources? Like in this document, we recommend to use URIs as identifiers of data on the web. How to gather feedback? One important aspect of data on the web. When you provide as a consumer, provide feedback to a publisher. So you establish a communication between these two different actors, as Carol just showed you previously. And which data formats to use? It's an important question as well, because a lot of organizations and institutions don't know which data format to use. Is CSV the best approach? Publishing data in RDF format is the best approach. So we have a set of best practices that we try to answer these questions. Which are the data sources we are going to use? Which data to publish? Because it's not an easy task. You want to get the whole data set or the whole database you have in your institution and publish it online. It's not like that. So we show it in this document with a set of best practices trying to answer all of these questions. And from those questions I showed you, we got what we call data on the web challenges. Those are the challenges where we structured our document in sections. So each section has a set of best practices regarding this specific subject, like metadata. How to publish metadata on the web for humans and machines. So human-readable and machine-readable metadata. What's the best way to publish it on the web? Is it important to publish? How to do it? So another challenge that we have here is about data licenses. How to permit or restrict access? How to enable a conscious use of this data regarding a kind of license I'm going to use in my context? Another challenge we have is the data provenance and quality. How to add trust to data, how trustful that data is. So a researcher can use that data. The data, is the data trustful to be used for researchers and for other companies? So we have a set of best practices regarding that as well. And data versioning is how to track different versions of a data set. Which version indicator to use, how to manage those different versions. So we have a set of best practices as well regarding this subject. The data identification, we need to identify data sets and distributions. And we need to identify as well the data items inside a data set, how to identify those data and how to identify those resources. We suggest to use URIs to identify them. And about data formats, we have a section that is also a challenge of data on the web. And in data format sections, we show which formats to use, how to enable multiple formats to serving data. So we have a set of best practices covering this subject as well. Moving on, we have another challenge that we have in the document. The first here is the data vocabularies. So in this section, we try to answer the question of how to promote interoperability between data and data sets, how to use a vocabulary to get interoperability with them. And another challenge we have is the data access challenge. What are the access options we have? Access the data through an API, access the data through a web page, how to provide access to this data. The other challenge we have is the data preservation, where we have to have in mind how to keep that data for a long period online. When I publish a data, how I should preserve this data online to make it available for everyone is interested in. And the feedback section is one of the most important, because with the feedback, it's that a challenge as well. We try to establish the communication between a consumer and a publisher, and how to enable this communication, how a consumer can provide a feedback or a suggestion or a fix, a bug fix or something like that to a publisher. And so we have a specific section on the document covering this subject as well. The data enrichment section is where we say how to add value to this data, how to create data visualizations for that, how to process using artificial intelligence techniques for create more value for that data I'm publishing on the web. And at last, we have the data republication section. That is a challenge as well. And in this challenge, a consumer turns into a publisher as well, because a consumer will consume a data set and then will republish this data set with some modifications and changes it may have done. So how we structured this document was based on the data on the web challenges, and each one of these challenges is a section of the document, as I just said. And we have a total of 12 challenges and 42 requirements. And for the requirements, we have specified in each best practice. I will show you later. And this is the first image or a picture of our document. If you open on the browser, you will see a document like that. And we designed our best practice to meet the needs of information management staff, developers, groups like scientists interested in sharing and reusing data on the web. So we try to answer some questions that can be very useful for different groups and different actors on the web that are using data on the web. Moving on, as I just said, we have the requirements, the relevant requirements that we got from the use case and requirements document. So each best practice has a relevant requirement that it covers, like in this best practice 5, provide data provenance information. We have two requirements in this best practice, the prop available and the metadata available. So we have for all of the 35 best practices, at least one or more requirement that it try to answer. And after applying the best practice in your context, like in my organization, I'm going to use the best practice, I can reach some benefits. And each benefit represents a kind of improvement in the way of the how data sets and data are available on the web. So we have the benefits of reuse, comprehension, linkability, discoverability, trust, access, interoperability, and processability. And we have some specific best practices that tries to reach some benefits. Like for reuse, we have some linkability, another one. And I will explain each of these benefits and what you can get from them. The first one I'm going to explain is the benefit of comprehension, where humans will have a better understanding about the data structure and the data meaning, as well the data set and the nature of the data set. So not only humans will benefit of the comprehension benefit, but also machines, because as we said, all of metadata we publish on the web, it's ideal that it's for human and machine. So it's human readable metadata and machine readable metadata. And the benefit of comprehension will be reached for both, for human and machine as well. The processability benefit, where machines will be able to automatically process and manipulate the data within a data set. So if the data that I publish on the web is structured in some way that can facilitate a machine to process the data, an application to process that data as well, we can reach the benefit of processability. And the third one here is the discoverability benefit, where machines or applications in this case will be able to automatically discover a data set or a data within a data set. And for instance, I can use a specific vocabulary to publish data on the web. One example I can show you is like I'm publishing a news article on the web. I can use the schema vocabulary to describe that news article. And that news article can be processed and discovered by some crawlers on the web like Google or Microsoft Bing and Yahoo. The other benefit we have here is the benefit of reuse, where it shows that the chances of the dataset reused by different groups of data consumers will increase. Like when you publish the data on the web following certain criteria or certain best practices, you can reap the benefit of reuse, where other people will reuse that data, like a group of scientists or developers or other different groups can reuse that data you publish on the web. The other benefit we have here is the linkability benefit, where it will be possible to create links between data resources, be a data set or a data item. As I just told you, every identifier we publish on the web for data, it needs to be an URI. And as we publish a data identified by an URI, you can create links between these data resources. So in this way, you can reach the benefit of linkability. The other benefit we have here is the interoperability, that it will be easier to reach consensus among data publisher and consumers. And like the example I showed about the vocabulary, if two institutions are going to publish data on the web, but they use different vocabularies to describe the same kind of data, it's not a good practice for interoperability. So if they are publishing the same kind of data, the ideal scenario is that they publish it following or using the same vocabulary and the set of terms to describe that data. So this way you can reach the benefit of interoperability. The benefit of trust, where the confidence that consumers have in the data set will improve. So if you follow certain best practices, you can reach the benefit of trust as well. And at last, we have the benefit of access, where humans and machines will be able to access up-to-date data in a variety of forms and in different formats as well. And this benefit you can reach when you publish data on the web and you provide access, like using an API, using a Sparkle endpoint, using a different approach of access to that data you publish online. And those were the benefits I briefly showed to you. And here we have, as Carol and I just said, we had a more than 2 years work on this document and data on the web document. Now it's a W3C recommendation, so the document is closed for now. But we have another document, it's a note called DWBP Implementation Report, where we included all implementations and evidence of implementation of the best practices, like in DBPJA and schema.org, every context, every scenario, and every institution that publish data following the same approach we show in the best practice. So if you are gonna publish data on the web or fix some error you can eventually find in your data portal, you can follow the best practice and then you can send us an email or be in contact with us to include your case in our DWBP implementation report. So thank you so much for listening to us, and now I ask Carol, and we are going to open for questions for everyone.
Hey, Tom, are you there?
Yep.
Okay.
So, can you hear me now?
Yes, now we hear you.
Okay. So, I don't have, I don't see any questions. I'd like to ask, invite everybody to put in questions. So I'll start with a question. Do you recommend using techniques that embed the embed machine understandable RDF metadata in the web page, like RDFA? And did you talk at all about schema.org? Because there are different vocabularies that support the idea of embedding metadata into web pages. And can you comment on those?
Yes, sure. And we didn't show it here, but we have a specific page of example in the WBP document, and in this example
just a second, is my screen still sharing?
Yes.
Okay, so okay. You can see here, right?
Yes.
Okay, great.
Okay, we have an example page in our that we published and we created to publish with the document. And in this page, we have the metadata of a data set in a human understandable way, human readable form. And as well, we have a description of this data in RDF as well. In RDF, using RDFA. I don't know if you can see here. So we recommend to embed. We have best practice for that, to embed metadata in web page as well, either by using RDFA or JSON for linked data. Those are different approaches, but you can use to embed metadata machine readable in web page as well, and it's a best practice.
Yeah. Newton was showing the example we developed on the very first best practice of the document, which is actually provide metadata. So this is, as we explained in the beginning, if you remember that figure we showed you, this is the first figure using the document. And then that's why, based on that, on the data on the web contact, that we have our first best practice, this one, provide metadata.
Yeah, you can use it so to embed this metadata in our web page.
Okay.
Answer your question, Tom.
Okay. Can you comment on? I see some questions are coming in, but I have one more before I turn to the questions. Did you talk about the different ways, the different tools that are available, different types of tools that are available for creating metadata? For example, using content management systems to or static site generators, things that create the metadata when you're actually creating a document, and that convert those into metadata on the web in RDFA.
Actually, in the document, we don't recommend any specific tool or technology, because we try to write a document that is technological agnostic. So we don't recommend any specific CMS or other technology to do that. But as I use in my daily work, I have a kind of WordPress where I publish some data and I work a plugin that can get this metadata and structure this metadata in RDFA. I do the same with JSON LD in my personal website. So we don't recommend any specific tool, but there are many tools available for doing that.
Yes. Okay, we have a question here. Do the best practice guidelines address ethical issues of data sharing, privacy, for example, or intellectual property?
Yes, of course. The privacy is very important, of course, and we mentioned that in the introduction of the document, we talk about the importance of actually acknowledging privacy and, of course, don't sharing sensitive information about individuals, you know. So if you see this paragraph I'm highlighting here, you can tell depending on circumstance, sensitive information about individuals might include full name, home address, email address, etc., etc., etc. So it's very important to when you think about personal data, for instance, it's very important that you don't actually share any privacy information. So we talk about that, and it's like a prerequisite, you know, it's basic. So you cannot share anything that it's would be a personal data or would intrude the privacy of anyone. And do you want to comment?
And just to complement this answer of Carol, in data republication and data reuse section, we regarding the ethical aspect as well, when you are using a data set and republishing it, it's ideal that you cite the source of this data set. So it's important to make available who is the original publisher of that data set. So those best practices as well covers about the ethical.
Yeah, so if you take a look, for example, on the best practice 34, for follow license terms, that is one of the things Newton was mentioning. So the idea here is to find and follow the license requirements from the original publisher of the data set. So how can I say? I'm sorry that sometimes we take a while to figure out how to say in English since our main language is Portuguese. Thank you for your patience about it. So for example, we are thinking that the person who published already followed the first published actually, already followed the best practice, already is publishing according like using metadata, putting a license, data license, you know, taking care of the data provenance. So when you actually get to the republication, the person who is republishing it is actually getting from a data set or data sets that were published already with a license. And also, this is another thing that Newton mentioned that is very, very important. It's to cite the original publication. So it's to acknowledge the source of the data in metadata. So the idea is to provide a user interface, include the citation visible. So when you actually republish the data, you have this information there for everyone else. Where did you get that from?
Okay, we have another question here. Are there implications for international use of these best practices given the different laws that govern the citizens of different countries?
That's a great question also. Well, we had long discussions about it. Actually, I could give you an example that one of the discussions we had was actually the limits between the technical issues, right? And then the legal issues. Because I think it's important to mention regarding this question that W3C is a technical organization. So even though we are dealing with, we can mention the importance of privacy and this best practice 35, for example, that you can see there, that it's important to cite the original publication, and we are actually providing providing knowledge and providing best practices that are technical, so you can use as to construct public policy, for example. So if you work in a government, the idea is that you can use this as a technical subject, a technical matter, to make your public policy. So we don't have, for example, how to deal with a law here in Brazil that is different in the United States of America and is different in France or different in China. You know, we don't get on this matter of legal issues or public policy issues, because the idea is to provide technical information for publishers and users. However, I think it's important to mention that we got the challenge that and the requirements from the use cases from all around the world. So we had, of course, we don't have all of the use cases, we have a set of use cases, but it's worldwide. So we had some examples from many different countries, and also the best practice, so they try to accomplish all the technical issues there in different countries. Of course, we know that especially if you are dealing with open data government or open government data, I'm sorry, you have different laws and then that you have to follow. I can give you an example we have here in Brazil, for instance. So our federal government, it publishes data on the web for a while right now. It has a data catalog. And but it's still, we have access to information law, like a FOIA in US, but still they have technical issues that they haven't achieved. So I can give you this an example that we have a law, we have an article saying you must publish all the public information on the web in open data format, but still they can't achieve everything they should. And the best practice could help them to deal with the technical issues regarding that there's already a law. Not sure if I was clear in my answer.
Okay, thank you very much. I don't see any more questions, so I think this might be a good time to close the webinar. Thank you very much for to the two speakers, and thank you very much to the attendees. With that, I'd like to pass the microphone to Stefan. Do you have any announcements to make?
Hi, Tom. Thank you so much. Thank you to Caroline and Newton for the webinar. And thank you, Tom, for moderating. For those still here, the recording of the webinar and the slides will be made available within 48 hours of today's broadcast. We will try to get the links to you by the end of today. And that is all for me, and thank you once again.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Have a great day.
You too.
Thank you. Have a great day.
Bye.